Okay. Wow. What an amazing couple of days, and it's still amazing. So put your seatbelts on. I want to introduce Whitney Maris from the Campaign for Trauma-Informed Policy and Practice, CTIP. You've been hearing a lot about. Almost every job that I've ever had, I created a new niche because I had something I wanted to accomplish. And so I would go to a director or something and say, you know, I want to do this and I want to create that. And I would get like this job that was like, I didn't walk into a slot for the most part. I walked into something that I created, even the one that I have here at UNC, I created. And so Whitney has done the same thing. She created a position for herself and has been tremendously influential in influencing policymakers, in particular, in understanding trauma and the solutions that are evidence-based. And so she works in this space very concertedly. And she is the person, and I hope you all will stay to the end, who's going to do some advocacy training. Her advocacy training is actually on our website, and it's also on the CTIP website. She's extremely good at this, and she can help people to understand how to reach policymakers in an accessible way. So I'm going to try to introduce her with her new made-up title, which is, you know, like I said, exactly what I've done for most of my career. And you talk people into, I can do this. And you don't know if you can do it until you step into it, but you make other people think you can do it. And then you can prove it to yourself, and then you can prove it to others. And that's what Whitney has done. So, Director of Trauma-Informed Practice and Systems Transformation. Yes. Okay. And then she will introduce the speakers. What, one of whom has COVID. Yeah. And sent a video.
Thank you.
So it's why we should all be wearing a mask, and shame on me.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you. Big words, Jenny. Thank you. That's so kind. Yes, I am here to introduce a next session. Hope you are returning nourished and excited to keep going. This session is the cost-benefit analysis of trauma-informed policies. And to start, Dr. Jane Cooley Fruehwirth, the professor of economics at UNC Chapel Hill, also a fellow of UNC's Carolina Population Center, and an adjunct associate professor in public policy, will be joining us via a beautiful video. You're in for such a treat. And Jane, if you are watching this wherever you are, we are wishing you speedy recovery and uneventful healing. Thank you so much for preparing this beautiful presentation for us. And following that, Dr. Stephen Marshall and I, Dr. Stephen Marshall is a director of the UNC Injury Prevention Research Center and a professor here at UNC. He and I will be having a conversation after his presentation about that cost-benefit analysis and how we actually put that into action, how we turn that awareness into action, what it will really take to implement evidence-based solutions. So thank you so much. And I think that you can come up. I don't know how to play the video though. Just hit next slide, it will play automatically. Thank you. I wasn't prepared for a technological experience. Okay.
Okay. Hi, my name is Jane Fruehwirth. I'm an economics professor at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and also a part of UNC's Carolina Population Center. I am so honored to be given an opportunity to be part of this conversation. I was really looking forward to being part of the dialogue in person. And as luck would have it, COVID is making its rounds through my house, and I was not able to be there with you today. So I have recorded this instead. I also have to say that I come to you with a great deal of humility after hearing the talks from earlier today. I have learned so much from those of you who have spoken. And I know as an economist, I bring a very different lens. But I hope it's still, and we talk about a lot of adjacent concepts, but with a very different language. So I hope what I can say to you is still useful today. A lot of what I do as an economist is quantify effects, particularly thinking about the effect of schools on children's outcomes. And I think part of the value of economics in these dialogues is being able to think about the economic case for intervention. And so I hope that'll be useful for you today. So what is a cost-benefit analysis? So we use these to help make the case when we want to intervene. Sometimes interventions are really costly. So how can we evaluate whether the benefits derived from the intervention are worth the costs? And part of the challenge of this, which is seems a little distasteful, is that we have to put outcomes in economic or monetary units to be able to provide a direct comparison to costs. And of course, when the benefits, how we monetize them, exceed the costs, it's a win. But then there are a lot of challenges to do this. So how do we think about the full range of potential benefits? And how do we actually put a dollar value on those benefits? And I will return to some cost-benefit analyses of interventions at the end of this talk to give you some examples. Another lens we might have on this, which is one I've used a lot in motivating my own research, is thinking about where we can get the big bang for the buck. And so economics is known as a dismal science for a good reason. The reason is that the basic theory of economics is we have scarce resources. How can we leverage those scarce resources to deal with competing wants? And in this case, I'm thinking about how can we leverage scarce resources to promote resilience in the next generation? And I'm not claiming to have all the answers here. What I am gonna say is some examples of ways to think about this from an efficiency perspective. And so where we can get the bang for the buck. And so some examples I have in mind are that some periods of investment might have higher returns than others. Where can we multiply effects? And what kinds of skills matter? And can we, for later success or economic benefits, and can we find ways to target those skills? And so I'll think about each of these in turn in the ahead. And so again, as an economist of education, my interests really focus on schools. And so I spend a lot of time making the case for investing in schools, and it's not a hard case to make. So one argument from an efficiency perspective is that it's just a natural, easy, efficient place to intervene in the well-being of young people. They spend a lot of their time at school. It's a place we can go and have an effect. Another reason that we need kind of the call to invest in schools is because of these massive achievement gaps that we see. So by one estimation, the achievement gap between Black and white students is as large as 2 years worth of education. Achievement gaps by income are similar, even slightly larger in magnitude. And if we're thinking about putting an economic cost on this, we also know that education has huge effects on wages. And, you know, we care about more than wages. It has big effects on other important life outcomes, health, the well-being of the family, the well-being of future generations. So all these important life outcomes are affected by education, mental health as well. I have a student working on that question. And then maybe an interesting piece that economists bring to the table that isn't talked about as much is that when we think from an efficiency perspective, supporting schools early, so shrinking the achievement gap early, are improving individuals' capacity to find jobs and be productive in the labor market, is one of the best ways to break the poverty cycle. And the reason that's the case is because you create a more productive workforce that expands the pie. By contrast, when you have to redistribute wealth later on, when people are already out in the workforce, we know that any way of doing that creates dead weight loss, which is just a fancy way of saying it kind of shrinks the pie, so the amount of money available. And I just want to be super clear, I am not saying that we don't need redistribution right now. So we need redistribution because of the magnitude of the wage inequality that we have in our society today. But the ideal from the efficiency perspective would be that if we can invest early, then maybe we would need to do less redistribution later. Now here I can pull from a very famous economist, Jim Heckman, who's a Nobel Prize winner and is well known for making the case for not just investing in schools, but investing early. He's brought together lots of evidence on early childhood, so 0 to 5 interventions, such as Perry Preschool, where they invest not only in the child's education, but the family and health. And he's also considered some other early childhood interventions here in North Carolina. And the evidence is super clear. There, even though these programs are incredibly costly, there are huge returns on investments and the benefits last. And I'll return to some of those cost-benefit analyses later. Another place where we can really think about bang for the buck is when I was thinking about multiplying effects. And one way we multiply effects is caring for our leaders. And I think about this particularly in the current climate we have in our schools and my concern about that. Principals are dropping out at a really high rate. It's increased to 17.5% attrition. I have a similar graph here for teachers. The attrition is now at close to 16% of teachers leaving the profession. And the consequences are big. We know that teachers matter for student success. And if we can't retain them, this really hurts the potential of kind of catching up from the pandemic and helping students to succeed. And I think less studied, but equally important, are that principals matter. They set the school climate, which we know matters a lot for student achievement. They support the teachers, they support the students. I mean, who do teachers go to when they have problems? They help with instructional development. And by some estimates, matter almost as much as teachers. For children's achievement. So let's not lose sight of the principals. Another way I think about bang for the buck is thinking about the social context. So can we harness peer power? So there's a lot of research showing that the social context matters for a range of outcomes. And one way this means that often just a one size fits all policy isn't right. We need to think about the context in which that policy is implemented. But I think in terms of the bang for the buck angle, really thinking about how benefits of an intervention aren't just helping the child, they can also spill over to the child's classmates, to the child's neighborhood, to the child's family. And this can create even more of a return to the investment than we originally think. And so just to give like kind of a simple example, but suppose you've taken a child who's behind in reading and you've improved that, you've found ways for that child to catch up so that now they can be productive and engaged in the classroom. That's going to create a better learning environment for all the students in the classroom. And then finally, we can think about peer power in terms of multiplying effects. So I think of this classic example of my memory as a child having a substitute teacher come into the classroom. And somehow this well-behaved class just kind of goes haywire, and we feed off of each other, and bad behavior spreads and bad behavior. And we also know with social media, there are these great influencers. And so we can think of peers as a way of spreading contagious behavior that we actually want to occur within the classroom or within the neighborhood, or the role of influencers to really spread the effects of a policy beyond the initial people who are targeted by it. I also think it's really important to think about the type of skills we focus on as economists. We often focus, I apologize if language is different here, but we often focus on cognitive skills because of their strong tie to wage outcomes and the ability to monetize these and the importance of these. But increasingly, evidence is suggesting that non-cognitive skills also matter for labor market success. And so we shouldn't lose track of those. And when I say non-cognitive skills, the language is used to kind of denote everything else, which is a little frustrating, but it's locus of control, social skills, motivation, for instance. And, you know, perhaps some of the research here is surprising too, because it's, and this is based on a review of the literature I'm citing here, but it's suggesting that non-cognitive skills may actually matter more than cognitive skills for labor market success. So increased wages more. And that these effects of these non-cognitive skills has grown over the past few decades. And so the question I wonder about is, if these non-cognitive skills are so important for life outcomes, and particularly for wages later in life, are there ways that schools can help promote non-cognitive skills, and how can they do this? And this has been part of my reason for engaging with individuals at the North Carolina Department of Instruction and the Socio-Emotional and Learning Division. They do amazing work there thinking about the learning environment as social and emotional, and how that's important, an important understanding for shaping how we teach the students. And I think more work and emphasis along this way, it not only changes how we teach, it changes how much students can learn, both in the cognitive dimension, and it also creates a better equipped workforce in terms of non-cognitive skills that are needed in the workplace. And lastly, I have to talk about mental health. I know for this audience, I don't need to tell you that the statistics are alarming, that rates of psychological distress among young people and adolescents are higher, increasing at higher rates than older age groups even before the pandemic. And the situation with mental health has just worsened during the pandemic. And this is an area of research I've been really interested in, partly just motivated by my personal experience of working with college students and seeing increasingly the struggles they have to succeed in college, and a lot of this relating to mental health. You know, what is the cause? That's kind of the million-dollar question. There could be a lot of factors. Performance stress, social media use has been shown to be related, environmental stress, discrimination, bullying. But what I want to emphasize today as the economist is that the potential harm from this can't be overstated in terms of monetary terms. So mental health has been shown to matter for academic success, for job success, for well-being, for family well-being. All those are things that we can put a dollar value on. And I think it's important to acknowledge here that it raises the question of how do we care for the whole student, the whole child, and not just the bundle of skills that we're producing, but we're thinking about their larger mental health and well-being. And along these lines, while I think of a whole range of potential interventions to support our students, I think what's most startling and perhaps one of the more alarming things that's been coming out lately in terms of mental health is how under-resourced we are to support our children with mental health providers. And we see this in our schools. We see this in our universities. And so here is just from a recent report from the Department of Public Instruction about how under-resourced our K-12 schools are. For instance, one counselor for every 335 students, where the recommended ratio is 1 to 250. And we see this not just in our schools, just to emphasize this, there have been recent stories about this across neighborhoods and counties. How do we improve access to mental health support when so many people are in need right now? And so to circle back to the cost benefit side of things, where we're actually going to put some dollar values on these things, not just talk about efficiency, but put some dollar values on it. So a 2007 study that was supported by the National Academy, the National Academies, estimated that the cost of mental, emotional, and behavioral disorders was $247 billion, and this is in 2007 dollars, or $2,380 per young person, meaning age 0 to 24. Importantly, what is included in the cost? Well, they thought about the health of the individual. They thought about the health of others that was impacted by this. And then how this in turn led to how these disorders led to decreased productivity in the labor market, had education consequences, and increased utilization of services. Importantly, these costs do not capture everything. And I think that can be the frustration with cost-benefit analyses. They don't fully capture the quality of life or this experience from these improving these mental, emotional, and behavioral disorders, or the effects of reducing behavior problem behaviors and symptoms in the range that don't meet the full clinical criteria of mental, emotional, and behavioral disorders. So already we're showing the cost of these disorders is large, but is still likely a vast understatement of the cost. And so just to end with a couple well-researched interventions where we can compare the benefits to the cost. So early childhood interventions are the most researched. And so I found this example of a meta-analysis that estimated that the per child benefit of these early childhood interventions was $11,000 and the per child cost was about $5,000. So that's a huge return. Another study showed that for Perry preschool, that the per child benefits were $240,000. I mean, that's huge. And the cost was only $15,000. And I know if you're just there trying to sell the cost, that's hard, but if you can put it in the context of these amazing benefits, I think it could really improve our ability to make change. Another example that was provided in this review is the youth development interventions that aim to improve parent-child relationship and reduce problem behaviors. They've been shown to yield a net benefit per child of well over $10,000 in many cases. So another example of an intervention that's shown to be well worth the costs, even if the costs are high. And so what I hope you took from this talk, well, thank you for your patience with me trying to monetize something that is intensely personal and intensely important, regardless of the monetary cost. But I discussed the basic principles of a cost-benefit analysis. We considered some ways to think about how to get bigger bang for the buck, thinking about critical periods of investment, critical players, or ways to support the caregivers, and thinking beyond cognitive to like a broad range of skills, and particularly thinking about the challenges around mental health. And then we also considered some examples of cost-benefit analysis that make really a compelling case for the benefits of prevention outweighing the cost. Thank you so much for the invitation to be here. I am really appreciating listening to all your amazing insights from afar, and I look forward to connecting with you in person one day. Thank you.
Stephen Marshall, the director of the UNC Injury Prevention Research Center and professor of epidemiology, to do a presentation, which I might interrupt with some wonderments if I get curious about anything in particular as he speaks. And so take it away, Dr. Marshall.
Hey, thanks a lot, Whitney. Yeah, so hi, everyone. It's great to see you all here. And I'm just going to say, give yourself a round of applause, right? And then I'm going to say, give Jane a round of applause. Because in my career, I've interacted with a lot of health economists, and she is really good. And she's really good at explaining to you the limits of her science, right? Which is that it doesn't capture every aspect of our personal experience. It doesn't even begin to capture our individual lived experiences. But those numbers are helpful for putting for what Whitney does, right? Because she has to explain to people that these programs really do not only pay for themselves, but we can't afford not to do this. We can't afford not to do this, right? So that's, I think Jane was telling us that. Like these are real, like if this was a hedge fund, we would all be rich. Right, you know, because the return on investment is really, really high, but it takes a long time to realize that return on investment. Now, I also want to say that I want to give a round of applause to all the people who've shared the details of their life. And I'm not going to bore you with the mundane details of my life, except to say that I grew up in New Zealand, So I do have this thick New Zealand accent. It's called a Kiwi accent. It doesn't refer to the fruit. But if you can't understand what I'm saying, you just need to throw up your hand and say, what was that? And we will explain. So I'm gonna do some slides, right? Oops, did they? Oh, here it is, I can see it now, right. So I figure you've had a lot of experts talking at you already. And I kind of would like to hear from all of you in the room. So I'm just gonna maybe go through a couple of slides and then ask you some questions. And now I can see Demi's like, we do promise to be off the stage in time for Justice and everyone else who's gonna be here at 1:45. We're not gonna drag on, and I'm gonna set my little timer because Whitney is far too nice to pull me off, right? Yeah, no, I just don't want to be subjected to the torture that she's got prepared for me. She gives me up. So I think many of you are familiar with this model that we termed adverse childhood experiences, right? Which, if you think about it, is actually stressing the wrong thing. But anyway, there's a lot of scientists and people who do research studies angsted about this model for a long, long time. But, you know, it seems to be working pretty well in terms of bringing us together, helping us interact, have these kinds of conversations, and seeing how our work fits together. I also want to stress that, you know, I want to acknowledge CDC who put together these nice graphics. This is why our work is so important, but also why it takes a long time to realize the change, right? It's because when we have cumulative adverse experiences during our life, defined as, you know, as I say, this is not perfect, but it's something. Substance abuse in the family, parenting techniques that are far less inoperable, not enough money in the household, you know, that is a corrosive environment to grow up in. And when you're in that environment, it not only creates bad behavior patterns, many of which I have, but it also, when you get stressed as an adult, your fallback position, as we all know, is what you grew up with, right? So we need to enter, and that is what I like to call the intergenerational transmission of violence, right? And what I can show you is specific programs, some of which you already do, that will interrupt the intergenerational transmission. So the sooner we can break down violence being passed between people and from parents and other people in the extended family into children, the sooner we realize not just a better life for our society and our people and one another, but the economic gains, right? This is supposed to be an economics talk. The other thing is, like, this stuff really does change you physically. Like, it doesn't just lay down behaviors. Behaviors, like, don't appear out of nowhere. They're in your brain, right? And it changes the chemistry of your entire metabolism after a while, right? Now, this is not to say anyone's doomed, but we settle into this thing when we don't have stability, we don't have a job, we don't have a roof over our heads, we don't have a parent who loves us, we settle into this thing called fight or flight response. And that's a real biochemical change. That doesn't mean it's reversible or can't be corrected. We just should recognize that there is a biology here. Okay, so this is not a perfect model. Scientists always love to make disclaimers. But one thing I love about ACEs is we can track them over time, right, Whitney? We can see, you're about to interrupt, I could just tell. So we can actually monitor our progress over time. And I think this is really important for us to do because we can't unlock the hidden benefits, economic benefits of our programs if we can't demonstrate that we're having an impact with our programs. And when I say programs, I mean the work that all of us are doing, because us scientists also volunteer and work in the programs as well. All right.
Is it okay if I
interrupt? You can interrupt, okay, but you better be faster than that.
And you'll work close on time. I'm curious to know if you can speak a little bit to, you mentioned state level monitoring. What makes that particularly important? And what do we actually need to pay attention to understand that aspect of things?
Yeah. Do you want to try it again with the microphone on this time?
Is it not on? I thought my voice carried. Yeah. I'm curious to know, on the last slide, you had state level monitoring. I'm curious to know what that looks like, why it's important, and what the indicators are that we're looking to.
Well, if I was a business investor, which I'm not, and you don't want to invest with me, I would say, what's the problem? How can I fix it? And how can I know that it's been worked on? So, you know, CDC has a survey called BRFSS. It has an ACES module, and states do have to pay for this most years. But if we run that module through random digit dial, cell phone dial, first of all, we're always shocked at how prevalent ACEs are in the adult population. We knew it, but statistically, it doesn't look good. Two, we can see how we compare over time. Like, are we making progress? Are we reducing the number of people who are exposed to adverse experiences during their childhood? Or is it getting worse, right? I think if it's getting worse and we're doing all this work, then someone else needs to be held accountable because someone else is making it worse, right? Because we're working as hard as we can. Tell me who feels that they don't have enough to do or that they're paid too much money, right? If you are that person in this room, I'm following you because... All right. So I know we aren't supposed to enjoy vaccines quite as much as we did in 2018, 17, and 19, but there is a vaccine for ACEs, right? And it's building positive childhood experiences. And this is what many of the people in this room do. And dang, this didn't reproduce as well as I wanted. But there is an evidence base around all of this work. So everything that's listed on the slide that you can't read very well because I didn't calibrate the colors, sorry. There is research evidence behind every single one of these strategies, right? And so that's my primary message for you all, is to know that the work that's being done here is based on scientific evidence. But as scientists, we've yet to figure out, is there a shortcut? Do we have to do all of this? You know, and you actually know that better than us in a lot of ways. But, you know, empirically, it would be nice if we could say, you have to do two of these three and, you know, one to two of the following five. Like, it would be, at the moment, we don't have a magic formula, partly because we haven't really, don't have enough deployment of these things. So as a scientist, I would like to be able to tell your organization, this is the optimal solution for this state at this point in time. And when you move down to 20% prevalence of ACEs, then you need to move into this modality, right? To do that study, and I'm all about doing studies and publishing data, that's how I make a living. I really need mass deployment of positive childhood experiences. Like, I need, this is just so I can get a paper out, people. I need to smother the nation in positive. And you know what? Even if I don't get a paper out, it can't hurt, right? Okay, so we're gonna do this. You and I, Whitney, we're gonna smother the nation in positive. So we do a lot of research and we look at these things in isolation and we turn them into teachable nuggets that we share with elected officials and other policymakers. But I really wanted to speak to this study, which my colleague, Dr. McNaughton Reyes, is doing. She's been working in this field basically for longer than she wants me to share with you. But in this current generation of research, she's working on this Mums and Teens for Safe Dates. And how this intervention works is it works with children who are exposed to violence in the home when they were young. And in this study, we have an intervention that we deliver remotely through phones and computers to the mom and the daughter in this particular study. But there's no reason why it can't be the son. This is all based on evidence. and research studies, this is a known intervention that decreases suicidal behavior, depression, dating violence, sexual assault, and in males, some males, discretionary weapon carrying to school. So it's a very powerful product, but it depends on creating conversations between mothers and daughters, but could be mother and a son, that otherwise wouldn't happen because we're too busy picking up kids, making lunch for tomorrow, trying to worry about, you know, paying bills this weekend and everything else. As parents, we have so many concerns, it's hard to make space. And then, of course, the kids don't want to talk to us. They want to hang out with the other kids. This is a product that creates, in a structured way, conversations between high school age, middle school age children and their parents about what happened to that mom. And that's how you break. Like, I can't reach in and break it, but I can create a platform by which families can break it. You know what I mean? It's about empowering parents. So there are economic benefits. And then we do have this money coming into the state as well, right? Because substance use is a big part of this. So
is it okay if I interrupt you again before you move on? Okay.
Yeah. One of the things I'm struck by, you just shared those solutions and I see this sort of personal connection, but I'm curious as to how that ties in with that social ecological frame, the micro, the meso, the macro. How do you join those?
Oh, I don't know. That's for you guys to figure out. It's a great question though. Right. I think you just have to blitz it at the moment, right? Because I think you need to, so we need to make it as family friendly as possible. And then that means policy change to, like, for example, you know, nutritional assistance for families that have less financial stability. The things that make a difference in people's lives: having a job, having a roof over your head, having healthcare, and having someone who loves you, right? Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So that's not a magic formula. That's just from personal experience. The question is, how do we create those things in the entire nation and pay for them, right? And then I can come back and answer your question, which is, what's the magic formula for that place at that point in time?
Yeah, connect those dots for me, please.
All right, great. So I thought you'd ask. So it turns out that the cost of doing nothing is our entire military budget, right? Like this, you know, this is purely by chance, but this is what our military expenditures are per year, $750 billion. Like, that's our military expenditures. Just happens to line up. So my pitch to policymakers is, I can double your military spending budget if you want. You just have to give me $56 billion for 12 months, right? But in return, you'll get back $750 billion. It's a good investment, right? That's what my colleague was telling you all. The work you do pays huge dividends, but not directly and not to the people who pay for your programs. So what I would like to do is open up your programs to investors, right? Because I think we're missing, to take this to scale and smother the nation, we need investors, right? If it's this good an ROI, why don't we invite industry, financial brokerage firms to bankroll us? And all we have to do is just, no different from when you issue public bonds to build a freeway or to create sanitation or clean water. This is social infrastructure. It makes sense to have a bond issue. And $56 billion is a nice round number. And then those bonds will pay dividends to the investors. Social impact funds, right? Because, you know, and I think Jane was telling us this in her presentation. The truth is this. We all know this. A healthy childhood is absolutely priceless, right? It's That's what Jane was telling us. It's beyond measurement. But in order to get there, we may need to open ourselves up to some innovative models for how we get the capital to create all these healthy childhoods. Because once again, if any of you feel that you have adequate funding for what you're trying to do, I would love to hear about it.
Ditto.
All right, I'm right at time and I apologize for going on for way too long. I would say that in my life, there've been two types of learning. There's been learning from life experiences and learning from books. And book learning has paid the bills and put food on the table in my household. But you know, learning from life experiences is ultimately the purpose of that book learning. So I think in partnership with research and practice, we can achieve a lot. But I think we're also a little bit hampered by our scope. We need to be thinking out of the box and looking to promote our programs. All right. I know we got to get on to the real people who've got important things to share with us. Thank you, Demi, for the chance to.
I think we're looking at this. This could be looked at differently because the model that we are always looking at is the health people thinking that they won't give back. But if we can actually move people from poverty to prosperity, they're going to be ones that will pour back into the system that helped them to rise. And we won't have to keep looking for outside investors to do it. So that when it's like that each one reach one, each one teach one, that person then is prepared to go out and teach. It's like taking a person and helping them to learn how to fish so they can eat for a lifetime. But if we keep pigeonholing people, keeping them in the cycle of poverty so they can't get out of it, then they can't ever give back, even if they want. So if we can move people, it's not like there's not enough room at the top for everybody. We just don't have an abundance mentality to say, I'm willing to step over and let somebody who doesn't look like me or behave like me or act like me to be here with me, because that makes me uncomfortable. And so we really need to look at if we actually move people from poverty to prosperity. African Americans are known for being the demographic that spends the most amount of money. There's no reason why if they were actually put in a position to understand their wealth power, that they wouldn't change the world in a different way.
Amen to that. I agree. I think that's a system to change, to move from the, what was your term? The abundance mindset, move out of the poverty mindset. We need to do that. So I hear you. Thank you. I'm sorry to hang out.
So our next session is going to be talking about the actual building of trauma-informed societal systems. And we're very happy to have representatives from different sectors of our society who are looking at this issue from various lenses. From the judicial system, we have LaToya Powell, JD, who is the Deputy General Counsel at the North Carolina Department of Public Safety. From the healthcare sector, we have Dr. Frank Casablanco, who is the AHEC Director and Chair of Continuing Professional Development at Mountain Area Health Education Centers, or MAHEC. From the educational sphere, we have Dr. Rodney Trice, who is the Deputy Superintendent for Teaching and Learning, Systemic Equity and Engagement in the Chapel Hill, Carrboro City Schools. And representing the cross-sector community coalitions, we have Ingrid Cochran, who is the CEO at PACES Connection and an adjunct professor at Tennessee State University. Ms. Cochran is going to be joining us remotely, and I'm welcoming our speakers in person.
Thank you. Do us a stand or whatever you would be comfortable with, you could all sit, or you can
And how do we advance? Oh, there we are. Oh, there I am. Good afternoon. Oh, so hard to go after lunch and near the end of a two-day, just absolutely phenomenal summit with so many amazing speakers, but such overwhelming information. So I know everybody's tired, and I'll try to stay within my 15 minutes in talking about what we're doing in the court system to incorporate trauma-informed practices. As she said, my name is Latoya Powell, and I am Deputy General Counsel for the North Carolina Department of Public Safety, where I serve as the Chief Legal Advisor for the Division of Juvenile Justice. And I have the absolute pleasure of working very closely with our secretary, our deputy secretary, Billy Lassiter, whom you heard from this morning, who is just a phenomenal, very dedicated public servant, but also a very gifted public speaker. And I'm so glad I didn't have to go immediately after him. But I do serve as the legal advisor for juvenile justice, but I'm here today as a representative of the Chief Justice's Task Force on ACES Informed Courts. Before I get to that, I'll just tell you a little bit about myself and sort of what caused me to be appointed to this task force. I've spent the last 18 years working as a juvenile law attorney at every level of state government. I've been a prosecutor working at the ground level in juvenile court, prosecuting kids. I have been an assistant attorney general working at the appellate level, also working on juvenile delinquency matters there. I've also served as in-house counsel for now two state agencies. First, the North Carolina Administrative Office of the Courts, which is the judicial branch, and now at the Division of Juvenile Justice. I also spent several years as a law professor at the UNC School of Government, where I taught juvenile court judges and other practitioners who work in our juvenile court systems. So you might be surprised to learn that the first time I heard about ACES was 2 years ago when I was appointed to the Chief Justice's Task Force on ACES Informed Courts. That's very concerning because I was in a position of power and authority where I was making decisions about children who came into the juvenile court system as a prosecutor, but as the last several years as a policymaker, where I'm in a position to help our agency develop policy and legislation to improve the administration of juvenile justice in North Carolina. 2 years ago, it probably would not be uncommon for most attorneys and judges working in the juvenile and criminal justice systems to have the exact same response, that they had no idea what ACES are. The Chief Justice's task force is trying to change that. So we're at the point where now, if you mention that to a court official, they're probably aware of what ACES are, but we're now trying to educate and help our court officials gain an understanding of what ACES are and how they impact the individuals they encounter on a daily basis. So this is a picture of the task force at its inaugural meeting in August of 2021. Chief Justice Newby, who is front and center, established this task force a little over 2 years ago after he learned about the original ACES study and how the ACES research was being used to build more resilient communities in places like New Hanover County, which I think somebody here mentioned the resiliency task force there, which was established several years ago. So in the picture here, just to the left of the Chief Justice is the elected district attorney from New Hanover County, Ben David, who is the person who brought this research
and information to the Chief Justice and said, we should be doing this all over the state. That planted the seed for the Chief Justice's task force on ACES informed courts. And so realizing that courtrooms are filled with people every single day, both children and adults, who have been impacted by ACES, the goal in creating the task force was to help create a more resilient North Carolina by making our courts trauma informed. And so I said that I had just heard about ACES for the first time 2 years ago. And by that, I mean the research, the study, the impact. Obviously, as a juvenile court practitioner, I've encountered trauma in the juvenile court system. I also have lived experience. The very first task force meeting at the AOC headquarters in Raleigh, we all the members of the task force, took the ACES test. And as you know, there's a score from 1 to 10. Mine was a 6, very easily, highest score in the room. So won't go into all of the reasons for that, but very easily, I could have been one of those children who came through the juvenile court system that I prosecuted many years ago and who I'm now trying to serve in the role that I currently hold in the juvenile court system. But thank God for resiliency, right? So instead, I'm here talking to you today about how we're trying to increase resiliency throughout the state. So these numbers are familiar to probably those in the room. And it reflects exactly what I saw as a prosecutor many years ago. Nearly every child that came into the courtroom had experienced poverty, had experienced inadequate parental support. Not uncommon for children to walk into delinquency court without a parent. No parent shows up, bothers to even show up to court, or they have parent, the maybe one parent who comes who's addicted to drugs. And suffering from substance use. And so we all know that comes with neglect, food insecurity, all sorts of things, trauma that impacts children in those situations. And so these numbers that show that, yes, nearly every child in the juvenile justice system has experienced at least one traumatic event. Most of them have experienced many. And those numbers increase the deeper the kids get into the system. So this morning you heard Billy talk specifically about kids who are confined in facilities. And those numbers get way higher when you're talking about kids at that who are that deep into the system. Many of the kids in our system have an incarcerated family member, parent, sibling, or somebody else in their family. And then, as I said, many of them have encountered substance abuse, domestic abuse, and mental health issues in their homes. All of that trauma leads to the behaviors that ultimately land them in the court system. And as we've heard many times throughout this conference, several speakers have repeated that early intervention is better. So we are trying to figure out how can we identify those kids early and immediately address the trauma so that we can help to not create that cycle of recidivism that's ultimately gonna get them deeper into the system. So I looked at several studies, and this is data from a study out of Washington State that found that juvenile offenders experience 3 times more ACEs than the original ACEs study population. Obviously, the higher the ACE score, the greater the likelihood that you're gonna end up with those negative public health and behavioral health outcomes. But the reason why we have the ACES task force is because we also know that that's a predictor of delinquency and crime. So we're trying to not only reduce crime rates, but trying to help better serve the people who are currently in our system. And that starts with the youth. So the mission of the task force is to enable court officials, not just judges, but prosecutors, public defenders, clerks, magistrates, all those folks, to be able to understand the impact of ACEs and address them when they see them. Our task force is representative of pretty much every stakeholder group in the court system. Judges, attorneys, both prosecutors and juvenile defense attorneys, clerks, law enforcement officers, juvenile justice representatives, child welfare representatives, academic leaders, researchers. We are supported by numerous subject matter experts from various philanthropy groups and universities and several organizations which have been represented here today or over the last 2 days. The beauty of this summit is that I kept seeing all these folks that I have met over the past 2 years through our work with the task force who have just been invaluable supporters of this work. So Dr. Kelly Graves of the Kellen Foundation, Liz Starr Weiner of Hope Starr Foundation and the Weiner Family Foundation, Dr. Marshall, who just spoke from UNC Injury Prevention Resource Center. All of these organizations have contributed to the work that we're doing to create trauma-informed courts and many more. This is just a snapshot of some of the supporters. So obviously the goal is to get to a place where court officials are viewing and approaching their work through a trauma-informed lens, trying to move towards asking what happened to you instead of what's wrong with you. We've heard about that a lot. So what are we doing? A lot of what we're doing, you've already heard about. So this makes it really easy for me because so many people have spoken before me about some of the wonderful initiatives. But there are really three key strategies that we're using to implement trauma-informed practices in the court system. That's early identification, education, educating our court officials, and then creating programming to support those who are impacted by ACEs. So you already heard about the YASI youth assessment screening instrument that we implemented in juvenile justice a few months before the ACEs task force was created. We had already started implementing the YASI tool, but through the collaboration with the ACEs task force, we were able to incorporate the ACEs score into that assessment tool. Also, we have collaborated with the ACEs task force to develop various educational tools and resources for judges to help them understand how to use it to make more trauma-informed decision-making in juvenile court. So we've got educational videos that provide an overview of the YASI wheel that identifies the juvenile's risk, needs, and strengths, as we heard this morning. And so judges are able to, there's also a bench card, this is a picture of it, but that judges can use to help them understand how to decipher that information and then interpret it to be able to inform their decisions. The task force has also created an ACEs bench card in collaboration with the Bulch Judicial Institute at Duke University School of Law. So I think I brought it with me. It's available at the AOC's website, nccourts.gov, but it's basically a trifold bench card that judges can have at their, essentially at their desk or in their chambers, that helps them understand how to communicate better when they do encounter someone who potentially has been exposed to trauma. So there are communication tools, there are sample questions that the judge can use, some that are child specific. There are tips for listening and de-escalating, all sorts of great tools that are just essentially right there at the desk or at the bench with them. We're trying to improve education about ACEs. So lots of new educational programs that focus specifically on educating court officials about trauma and how it impacts individuals in the court system has been developed in conjunction with the UNC School of Government, which does most of the continuing education for judges in our court system. And so I think you heard a little bit about some of that training, but one thing I wanted to mention is that now judges are able to obtain an advanced juvenile court certification that will take a total of 4 years to complete. But this is a program that has two tracks, one in child welfare and one in juvenile justice, that will help judges understand and become better equipped to incorporate those trauma-informed practices, something we've never had before in North Carolina. We also now have a new trauma orientation for new judges. So all new judges in North Carolina go through a new judges orientation with the School of Government. through the ACES task force and our collaboration with the School of Government, we have developed a new 8-hour session just on trauma, which will be the first day of that training. So all new judges will start to receive that training. And then I think you heard about the web-based training that is being created for all roles in the court system. And that is in collaboration with the Injury Prevention Resource Center. We also are trying to expand trauma-informed programming and develop new programming to address the needs of the youth in our system. You heard about school justice partnerships, safe baby courts. I forget who it was, but the speaker we had from 0 to 3 kind of stole my thunder there, because I was going to talk about House Bill 855, which was lobbied through the work of the ACES task force. We were able to get the funding in there to pilot safe babies courts in North Carolina. And we do have at least 5 counties who are interested in piloting. New Hanover, Mecklenburg, Brunswick, Durham, and Watauga counties have all expressed interest in being pilot counties. And please help your legislators know that they need to pass that bill so we can get the funding to do that. And then finally, to help educate and raise awareness about ACES, we've been hosting screenings of the film Resilience. The task force has obtained lifetime rights to screen this film. And so that is what we're doing. We've conducted many screenings with court officials and now are working on an HBCU tour where we're partnering with HBCUs in North Carolina to screen the film and then conduct panel discussions afterwards. If you wanna know more information about the task force or obtain any of the resources that I've talked about today, this is how you can find us. And I just wanna say thank you to everybody in this room, because this is all about leveraging assets to address trauma. And that's exactly what we're doing. We're leveraging all of the assets that you all have created through your knowledge and work and advocacy to bring this to the court system. So thank you.
Buenas tardes. How are you all? I'm from Western North Carolina, where on Wednesday, as I was rolling out my trash can, a bear greeted me. Because it's spring, and this baby bear had little babies all around it, and then I knew Mama Bear was close by. I'm also from my mom's work ethic. She was a CNA, single mom, raised me from the time I was 6 onward, and an immigrant to the United States, just like myself. And I'm from my abuela. And my abuela took care of me until the age of 6, so that I knew I would have food, I would have somebody there all the time. I'm from a community, from a neighborhood, where I was told, yeah, maybe you can get a job in the public health department. College, I don't know if that's in your future. You seem to run around with a bad crowd. And I'm from a nursing school where I eventually made it to, where the faculty wore white caps because they valued the profession. And they taught me my love of patience. And I'm currently from a community that has so many passionate people. And as I look out, I see an incredible number of them here. And online, I'm sure there's many, many more. And I start off with this because we are all complex individuals. There's such an intersectionality in the work that we do every day. I do a lot of teaching. I do a lot of work in healthcare. I do a lot of work in the community. It's hard to describe what I do. And I work for an organization that does all of these things in combination. And I happen to find a place that supported all of my passions. And so I'm going to start off with a depressing slide. We're very familiar with this, right? This is the infant mortality, and we've seen this for many, many years. And this is something that really moved me years ago when I was looking at the fact that we've made such little progress and have not prevented Black babies from dying. In my county, in Buncombe County, the rate several years ago when I got started doing this work was 3.8 times the number of Black babies compared to every one white baby dying. It's unjust, it's unfair. I knew that we had to do something different about it. And so we started asking questions. How do we go about doing this better as a health system? And so we decided not to go into the community and say, hey, let's do this, let's do that. We decided to hold information sessions in the community and ask them, how can we do this better? And guess what? The community knew. And so they said, very simply, teach us, train us. And so we started a doula program in collaboration with community members, with members from the community. And these individuals were trained to work with our OBGYN providers, to work with our nurse midwives, to work with our staff, and to go into hospitals and health systems and be part of a team. And so that infant mortality rate decreased to 2.4 times. Still unjust, still unfair. However, it's a move in the right direction. And it takes asking better questions, which is, in the world of trauma, something that we have to learn about. We've gotten many definitions over the last 2 days, right? We know that it is a wide spectrum. And understanding that piece of it is where healthcare doesn't do a great job, unfortunately, because we're too busy. The research is there, right? 20 plus years of research. We've seen these pyramids. We've seen all the graphs. We've seen the outcomes. It doesn't go in good directions. Years ago, as part of my role, we were able to bring both Dr. Anda and Dr. Felitti. We tried to get Dr. Burke Harris, but she said no, to present at a conference. Amazing, amazing. This was years ago when we're starting to understand a little bit more. And I asked them both the same questions, like, so what? What's next? What do we do? And they both said, you got to work on prevention, which is here. This is what you all are doing. And this is amazing just to hear so many different efforts where you're collaborating, where you're connecting, where you're actually bringing this to many different systems, not just healthcare. And that gives me a great deal of hope. Because in healthcare, it's a mess. I live it. I breathe it. I work with many providers that are burnt out, right? They're inefficient systems. They're very complex systems. The technology is the bane of their existence. They're like, I'm on till 10, 11 o'clock at night charting in these electronic health records. I have 10 minutes to speak with a patient. I can't ask them all these questions because what if they say something and then I got to do something about it? Who am I going to do something with? I have no time, right? And so all of these components, the access to care, the burnout piece, it's shifting to value-based care. I'm a little hopeful. I'm not 100% sure it'll happen. The intent is there. And the inequities, there's hundreds of them. Right? Infant mortality is just one of those pieces. And no one in this room has enough time. And so this is something that I present on many different slides, right? It's the window of effective tolerance, right? It's where in the ideal world, we'd be in that middle space, right? Where we can take everything in. And I believe, I've heard, I've seen the engagement this conference has done that. Because we've been able to disconnect from our worlds. We've been able to put our phones down, our computers down. We've been in that place where we can accept a lot of what we're hearing and take it in and process it. But yet in most of our lives and in healthcare, we're never there, right? It's either the hypo or you're just so worn down and you've seen 10, 15 patients in a day and it's still 7 o'clock at night and you have to chart. Or you have patients who are upset, they're angry, they're yelling at you. And how do you process all of these pieces? It's very hard. And this is not just in healthcare. This window is in everything, many different professions. And so to get out of it, a few different things, right? And we've heard many of these components of it. You know, how do you provide better training? If you know better, you do better. Thank you, Mama Kai. I believe in that immensely. But the training piece is only one component of it, because in healthcare, there's many different continuing education programs. I help to put on a lot of them. What do you do? What's the so what? What are the next steps? What are those implementation components? What are those collaboration pieces? And then when we're screening, we don't do a great job of asking better questions. So we need to ask better questions. We need to train providers and the community organizations. The work that many of you are doing have gotten there. You figured out how to ask better questions. You figured out how to engage the individuals and create safe spaces. These aren't big secrets. It's just putting some of these together into practice and allowing the work to happen. And those pathways to resources, oh my goodness, I couldn't stop writing with all of the different connections, all the different tools that I heard. I am excited to bring those back, but I'm not sure that many of them will be used because who has the time to do that, right? So we have to change the system part of it, right? And so collaborations, in my mind, are one of the biggest pieces that we do this, right? And having patients be part of those solutions. But you got to start by figuring out, where are you as a patient? Because so many times we go in and we follow these algorithms, and the bias, the implicit bias that sits in the healthcare world is tremendous. To undo that piece, to create that awareness that you got to not only listen better, but you also have to engage the patient and include them in those treatment plans. It's a big component of that. And then understanding the determinants of health, we've heard about them. We know all the acronyms, but what are they really? And where are those community organizations that are doing the good work that we should be providing the lift, the support for them to do better? It's not healthcare that's going to solve this. Healthcare can provide some of the funding. I was excited about the last two presentations because they did talk about the financial piece of it. Healthcare has a lot of money. They like to hoard it, right? It needs to be shared. It needs to be shifted, just like the power shift, into communities and into these community-based organizations. Healthy opportunities, wonderful example. Impact Health in our neck of the woods out west is funding this work. And yes, they're funding the components that will understand how to do better in food insecurity, housing, transportation, intimate partner violence. And those are really big. But then what are those connections into healthcare? And those are the next steps. That's the next phase of it. And it's very intentional, it's very thoughtful. And that part excites me because now you have accountability measures that go along with that. And that's the piece of it that healthcare has always been driven by. They're very number focused, right? Quality improvement, dashboards, you see them everywhere. How do we use them to embed this work and make it more accountable? Maternal health is something that I'm very passionate about, very personally vested in. Partnerships with the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services has been amazing. right? Because they've started doing work across the state, developing teams where you're combining not only community organizations, but you're having primary care, so family medicine, working with pediatricians, and developing these resources together. It's an amazing online map that we have in Western North Carolina that is just like the epitome of the resource combination in one place. It's very interactive, something that we'll gladly share. And then lastly, to finish out, the systems thinking, we've heard a lot of these components, right? But it's not an easy piece to integrate, but it takes building those relationships, building the connections. And I've seen many people exchange business cards and phone numbers and how do I get in touch with you? It starts there. You don't have to create huge systems, just start small, connect with one individual, get involved in one organization. I sit on 8 nonprofits, way too many, but I care about them. It's a lifetime appointment is the way that I think about it. It is something that to me has not only been impactful for my work, but it helps me to build those connections, to create that collective impact, and to leverage the role that I currently have to do better, right? To connect the health systems into a world where lots of times they don't want to connect into. And so I encourage you all, just make one connection into those health systems, because I guarantee you there's going to be somebody like me there that you can find. Gracias.
So good afternoon, everyone. So it's just great to be with you all today to talk about what I feel is perhaps among the most important work of our time. When I think about the why that brings us all together, I'm reminded of a quote by Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays, one of my favorite historical figures, author, president, past president of my college, Morehouse College. But he would say, "You are not what you now are, but what you aspire to be." You are not what you now are, but what you aspire to be. So as an educator, that really speaks to me, because my work essentially boils down to connecting students to their future self. And as an equity-focused educator, I am most concerned with anything that limits the possibilities of children, especially if those possibilities impact their education, academics, or social-emotional learning. But for educators, I'm going to tell you what's at the forefront of our minds is really the aftermath of the pandemic. We see what we're seeing in our schools is just totally different than anything that we've seen before. And I can't say that I've been in education 45 years, but I'm close to it. But we're seeing unsatisfactory attendance. Some say for Black and brown children, upwards of 50% of students aren't achieving satisfactory attendance, meaning they're attending school at least 85% of the time. We're seeing unwanted behaviors such as bullying and fighting, and a lot of that originating in social media, and I'm sure it's showing up in the courts as well. You know, teacher shortages, bus driver shortages. We haven't seen academic achievement this low in decades. But all of this are symptoms of the past 2 years of trauma that we've all experienced. And the trauma that many of our students and our families and even our staff were experiencing before the pandemic. And so what the pandemic has really done for us is just elevated the work that's needed and the work that we should have been doing all along. So instead of telling you about, you know, what schools are doing, I figured I'd ask you to join me in an experience and show you what we're doing, if that's okay. So if you can stand up, I would ask you to stand up. And with an elbow partner, I want you to find a common, something you have in common with your elbow partner. And I'm gonna give you a minute or so. Go to work.
We are both in really complex systems.
Yeah. We both have gray hair.
We both like to wear dark colors, while we are not wearing them today.
That is absolutely true.
I am 6 feet.
Oh my, no, it's my heels then. That's not a compliment.
All right, you're on a timer, 30 seconds.
We both went to-
You got your comment? You got your calendar?
Yeah. Are your eyes brown?
Yes.
We both have brown.
All right. Let me get your attention. So raise your hand if you found a common. All right. So right here, what is your common? Taylor Swift and children in school. Okay. All right. Let me hear someone else. How about my colleagues up here? Did y'all find a common?
Yes. We both like dark colors and we have glasses.
Dark colors and glasses. Like, I'm a part of that club. Let me hear one more common right there. Wear glasses and beautiful Black women. I can clap to that. So we're not done. So I want you, with your elbow partner, to talk about someone who inspires you. And I'm going to give you 2 minutes this time. 1 minute for one person, 1 minute for them, okay? And I know that can be difficult, talking about someone who inspires you. So you got to make it quick. Go to work.
That's easy. Hands down. Hardest working woman I'll ever meet. Strongest woman I'll ever meet. Loved to cook, loved to make sure that I did all of my work. She didn't know what I was doing, like schoolwork, but just would be like, what are you gonna do? And show me. It was something that was just a big part of who she was, to make sure that I was successful and I did better than she did. And so I was like, no, you're not gonna go to a trade school, you're gonna go to college. I'm just gonna be better than I'm gonna dream.
That everything you just said, I was going to say about Michael, who is also amazing and just inspires me just beyond words to know where she came from, different circumstances of having no education and getting married and have a child as a teenager, no education, money, opportunity to succeed, but she overcame a lot and supported 3 kids, ultimately as a single mom, and made sure that I went to college and had a better life, creatively able to create a better life for myself.
All right, might be time to switch.
And she was also, I have older brother and older sister, same thing. And so she came to the United States, left us with my umbrella, my grandmother in Colombia, and figured out, okay, this is how I can do it here. And my brother and sister, they were teenagers when she came, so they decided to stay in Colombia and then they came to the US. But yeah, she was single mom, never got remarried. I was like, no, I don't need a man. Like, they just came and had trouble, and nothing good would come of it.
All right, let's finish that thought. All right, let's come back together. I have to, don't sit down yet. Don't sit down yet. We're gonna do one more round, but I wanna ask, if you talked about a family member, raise your hand. Okay, now look around. If you talked about an educator, someone like that, a friend, raise your hand. So I think we probably have everyone, just about everyone in the room covered. So this last round, and then I'm gonna allow you to sit down and I'm gonna get to it. I want you to talk about, we're gonna do two more minutes. I want you to talk about something that changed your life. Something that changed your life. 2 minutes, go work.
Very easily meeting a Black female attorney when I was in middle school student, and knowing, seeing someone who looked like me in real life for the first time ever, in that career gave me the knowledge that I could do.
Yes. For me, it was my third grade teacher. He said, I believe you can do this. And just instill that confidence. And then I wanted to make sure it was, I remember it was a test about the continents, the bodies of water, and then something else. I can't remember the third thing, but it was something that I was studying because I really wanted to make him proud. And, you know, I got the highest grade in the class and a star, and like called me out positively. And it felt good. That was the first time that I could really recall being recognized for your achievements. And that was a big thing. I still like function like that.
Obviously, it's right? Still very front-loading.
I just grew up, I respond to people. So,
absolutely. Yeah, it's interesting. I tell people a lot that when I was in school, I was in the top performer. I went to most league all my school, but I was at the top of my class. And my teacher.
All right, let's take 30 seconds.
So I didn't really have any interest in becoming a teacher, but nobody ever told me.
All right, thank your partner and have a seat.
I first came to North Carolina 30 years ago, and it was so much fun.
Yeah.
So.
I can't do this one.
Yeah.
So I thank you for indulging me in that brief activity. Right. So if you know a little bit more about the person you're sitting next to than when you walked in the room, raise your hand. Right. So a lot of the statistics that we've been looking at and a lot of the challenges that I talked about in my opening, whether it's about attendance, it's about, you know, feeling less connected to your teachers or feeling less connected to your peers. For educators, and I would posit that for all institutions, it's about how we can humanize each other. And it doesn't cost a dime. If I can humanize my schools, my children will come to school to learn. So that's what we're doing. We're making intentional moves to infuse systems of care into our teaching and learning program. And so, and what we're focused on is this idea of safety. Because if I feel safe, if I feel valued, if I feel heard, I don't have to bring a gun to school or bully you. If I've made a social contract with you, it's difficult for me to get on social media to denigrate you. That's the work that we're doing. We're also talking a lot about voice and choice and agency. Schools being a place where, you know, students aren't just the consumers, but they put investment into the community. So there is a return. You put investment into each other. I timed it. It was 4 minutes. And you went from finding a common to talking about something that changed your life. And if you can do that in 4 minutes, what can we do over the course of years? We can transform this society. And the last thing, we talk a lot about building relationships. And the only way you can do that is spending time together. There's a portion of this task I usually do that's called connecting across difference, where you have to look at someone who is a different gender or a different race. And we don't spend enough time doing that. But those are the types of things that create a culture where it's safe, you're secure, and you can kind of find your circle. I want to end just by saying one more thing as well. We can't ignore the historical racial trauma that underlies a lot of the trauma that our kids and our staff and other community members experience. So a lot of school districts are fighting for equity policies and changing systems and structures. And it's difficult because our politics sometimes don't allow it. But we're going to attend to equity-focused practice where we have the courage to stand up and do what's right, whether you're a Black student, Latinx, LGBTQIA, it doesn't matter. I have to have the courage to stand up. And our institutions have to be anti-racist institutions, specifically, because that is a trauma in and of itself. And our institutions have to also fight for social justice, which means you're righting historical wrongs. You're operating outside of what you were called to do. So I'm an educator, but if I'm about social justice, I have to go to the community meeting when it's time to talk about affordable housing, because my families need to see me there. That's how you transform a society. And that's why this work is so important. When I look at what's here, the power that's here, I'm inspired. I thank you for allowing me to do a quick experiment. I hope you can invite me back one day. But instead of telling you about it, I think it's important that we experience it and humanize each other. Thank you very much.
Another emotional day. That's what's supposed to be up. Hey, I went to a lot of trouble to do these transitional slides, so we're going to look at that. And then this guy, we're going to take it down.
We're not at the break. There's one more speaker.
We do, yeah. That's what I came up with. Oh, my gosh. Ingrid, can you hear me? Ingrid?
Yes, yeah, I can hear
you.
You're
on. Are you going to share your slides? There we go. Thank you. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well. I hope everyone can hear me. I've been told I speak softly. So today I'm going to piggyback off of my other panelists and dive into cross-sector community coalitions. My name is Ingrid Cochran. I'm CEO of Paces Connection. I am going to take this time not so much to talk about how we create cross-sector community coalitions. Fortunately, North Carolina does a great job of that. I'm going to speak to why and how we can facilitate and improve. And so, just to give some background, first, I'm the queen of too many slides. So you'll get these slides, but I may not go through all of them. I want to first talk about, you know, give some context what we at PACES Connection do. We support communities to accelerate the use of PACES science. So the implementation, how we use this science to create or transform our systems. Currently, we have about 58,000 members. You are definitely invited to join if you haven't already. And we support 450 or so communities on our site. 33 of those are specifically in the state of North Carolina. They are city, county, and state level community initiatives. And as we look to how we transform our systems, All of our research has been very clear. Multi-sector community engagement is the way. And so as we look to how we coordinate our efforts, PACE's connection has really outlined three priorities. First is equity and healing-centered systems. As we look to prevention, positive childhood experiences, collective healing practices, and the facilitation of collective hope as key in our work together at systems level. Also, raising awareness of both collective and historical trauma. We at PACES understand that widespread awareness and understanding of collective trauma, especially as we are currently in one, well, two, and maybe three if you want to include racism, but COVID-19 is definitely a collective trauma. We are seeing the ramifications of 2020 still as we are 3 years out. That will continue. What we know from collective trauma is that the ripples can last decades, if not be passed along through generations. And we are currently in a climate crisis where the existential threat of climate change is definitely impacting not just our physical environment, also our collective mental health. And then raising awareness of historical trauma. This is the impact of intergenerational transmission of trauma, obviously systemic racism and other atrocious cultural experiences. With these three priorities and the efforts that would support these three priorities, they call for multi-sector work and collaboration. And so PACES believes that as we travel to the path of a just society, we have to move all of our systems, all of our sectors from being trauma unaware to being aware of trauma, becoming trauma informed, becoming PACES informed, where we understand that positive experiences act as buffers against trauma and adversity, and ultimately healing centered. We already know that North Carolina is paving the way nationally in this effort, as we have clear evidence by the discussions that we've had today. But as we look forward to what this looks like in real life, and also how we can expand the work, I like to use the Rye Center as an example of a social ecological model that takes into account our history and current dehumanization practices, and then how we can facilitate liberation and collective healing. The Rye Center is a youth voice organization out of California. And as I said, they do a great job of outlining what is needed and how we can transform systems. And so, let's look at dehumanization and distress. This visual helps us to understand how we got here when we think of social determinants of health, health disparity and inequity, and all of the other disparities that are essentially perpetrated by systems historically and presently. We clearly see at the individual level, obviously ACEs, intergenerational transmission, bullying, family system stressors. At the community level, we see atmospheric distress, community violence, lack of safe passage and safe spaces, underinvestment in over-surveillance of specific communities, and definitely exposure to sexual exploitation. And then as we move up, and this is something that's extremely relevant because this area, systems and institutions, is an extremely powerful system that is where all of our policies, procedures lie. And so you'll see there policies and systems such as the war on drugs, mass incarceration, segregation, anti-immigrant policies, climate violence, media assaults, displacement, and redlining. This is an extremely powerful system that really needs to be the first place where we have clear efforts to address or to facilitate collective healing at the systems level. And then lastly, we have history, legacy, and structure. This is where we find root cause. Root cause to our systems being in the space where they are, you know, perpetrating oppression, violence, and are ultimately the source of collective and historical trauma is nation building. This is where we have enslavement, genocide, colonization, economic exploitation, displacement, cultural hegemony, which is essentially saying that there's only one right way to be American, and white supremacy. This space feeds into all of the other systems that we have here, especially where it has systems and institutions. We have to be very clear that when we think about the efforts that we put in place, when we think about how we collaborate together to address our most intractable problems, that root cause is the fact that we have communities that have been disproportionately impacted by historical trauma, that those communities are often Black communities, Latino communities, LGBTQIA individuals and communities, and definitely, and when we think about North Carolina specifically, it's going to be also communities in Appalachia. This systematic oppression of these groups are drivers for the social determinants of health and other disparities that we see today. And so what does it look like for us to collaborate in a way to address these issues, to close these gaps? It requires a multi-sector approach with a focus on collective healing, a clear understanding that if we want to address the issues that we have in our present day society, that we have to go through a process that facilitates collective liberation. And so what does this look like at the systems level? When we look at this social ecological model, like I said before, the Rise Center has adapted this from Bronfenbrenner's original social ecological model. Bronfenbrenner is a child psychologist who believed that people developed not just in their homes, but within the larger society, that the issues of the larger society impact us all. And so in his work, he found that probably the most influential is the individual level, so the home, the family. The other most influential area for Bronfenbrenner would have been the macro system, which here is really highlighted in the history area on the Rise visual. And so this means that we must both honor resilience and fortitude in individuals, while definitely having a clear effort to address and clearly change our collective beliefs and values. So what are our collective beliefs and values? They lie in that dehumanization and distress area of nation building. No matter what we say in our country, our statistics that we've talked about today, the outcomes that we are trying to address, they all stem from the nation building section there. Our history of enslavement and genocide and colonization and economic exploitation. And in order to address that in a real way, we will have to engage in collective liberation, that our multi-sector efforts need to center around truth and reconciliation, reparations and redistribution, open borders or no borders, multiracial solidarity, and a reimagined social compact. And this is where things get hard. As we've talked about today, often, you know, politics can get in the way of this issue. But my belief is that PACES science is for everyone, for all, conservative, liberal, Black, white, everyone. And so as we engage in collective liberation, all will benefit. And so our multi-sector work needs to focus on truth and reconciliation. This means that we tell the truth about our past. We tell the truth about how we got here. It also centers around reparations. It means that we are focused in equity, that we give people what they need. And this is often around the lines of what they have historically not been able to have. And that we redistribute our resources. And then again, as we think through open borders and multiracial solidarity and reimagining the social compact of North Carolina, we have to be in the space where we are bringing everyone to the table. And so in our multi-sector work, this is where we move down into the lead with love and justice. We need to have everyone at the table. Courts are great, health, education, wonderful. But we also need to think about those other groups and individuals who need to have a voice at the table. Again, nothing about us without us. Do you have people with lived experience in positions of power and influence? Do you, when you have your task force that's addressing the criminal justice system, do you have someone who is formerly incarcerated? When you have someone at the table who is focused on food insecurity, do you have someone who lived in poverty as a child? You have to be able to have everyone at the table so that you can provide care and policies and interventions that are effective because they are driven by those with lived experience and can be very clearly aligned with that account of that lived experience. Often we spend a lot of money and time. We were talking earlier about return on investment, where we put in place policies that seem well-intentioned, but do not have the right people at the table. And therefore those policies are not as effective as they should be. And so when we think about multi-sector collaboration, we have to have people who have experienced systems trauma at the table. We also have to be wholeheartedly on board with collective liberation for everyone. This is where politics can get in the way. So in order for us to be able to facilitate that process, then we have to get down to the community level. If all that are at the table are a part of an institution, then you are disconnected from the community that you're serving. And so micro movements, neighborhood level movements are essential to multi-sector work, as well as those individual activists and influencers and advocates who may not be clearly aligned with a large nonprofit or a state agency. They also need to be at the table so that we can build beloved community. And this means that we engage in practices that ensure that everyone in our space understands how we got here. This is called a radical inquiry. This means that everyone in the state of North Carolina understands North Carolina's history and how we have gotten to the space where we have these disparities. They have a clear understanding of what are the poor policies that got us here? What are the institutional practices that got us here? This is something that everybody, every sector needs to engage in, that truth and reconciliation. How has the healthcare sector perpetrated health disparities? How has our legal system engaged in mass incarceration? How have our housing industry engaged in redlining and displacement and gentrification? And we clearly outline that this is the impact, and this is due to poor policies in the past and present, and not due to issues like the color of one's skin or how much money one makes. This allows for the community level transformation to occur, where there is a pushback on the narrative that your skin color, that your income is the reason for the impacts that we're experiencing. And this is not the truth. The structure of our country is the reason for the impacts that we are seeing today. As we engage in radical inquiry, we then empower those who are the most impacted, those who are experiencing trauma, especially oppression, to very clearly push back on the internalization of that, to become more civically engaged and to engage in these multi-sector community coalitions that we have presently. And we also need to engage in popular education. This is where we listen to people of color and other communities who have been marginalized, and we learn from them. And their givings, their offerings, and what they have to tell us then inform policies and inform the way that we operate. And this is how we will have effective multi-sector collaboration. This requires a lot. This requires a very clear process for addressing your political divides. I don't have the answer to that, but every region, every area is different. And but as we clearly understand that the systems are the spaces where we need to have this critical change, that means that we need to have the lawmakers and decision makers on the same page. And so that is really the next step in this multi-sector work, that we mend our political divides so that we can move forward with effective policies that are not just driven by what we think may be the answer because of statistics, which are driven mostly by scientific colonialism that tells us that certain groups are deficit based on the statistics and the research that we've done in the past. Now we need to move forward with an understanding that the systems that we have are the source of these disparities. And now we need to look to the communities and to the people for the answers. I also want to really put forward the understanding that PACER science is grounded in social justice, and that as we move forward, we need to take on not just the talk, but the walk, which is the most difficult as we set up our alliances and we set up our coalitions. Now we need to engage in the work of anti-racism. We need to engage in the work of reparations. We need to engage in the work of truth and reconciliation. I would like to thank you for inviting me here today to be a part of this discussion. I'm extremely proud of North Carolina. The work that you're doing is again, by far leading in the nation. And so thank you so much for having me today.